Well, Mr. Catania, we're going to talk about you, we're going to talk about city, we're going to talk about politics. But first, I want to ask you, where is Osawatomie, Kansas, and what does it mean to you? First of all, tell people what it is. And so, would you have to speak into the microphone?
All right, so Osawatomie, Kansas is a small town in Kansas where my mother is from and where I spent my summers while I was when I was younger. It's a small town that's in the north of the for those of you who know Kansas is flat. The north part of the city is the Osage River and the Pottawatomie. Actually, it's the River of Swans on the south. And so it was joined. It was founded in 1854 in reaction to the Kansas-Nebraska Compromise. It was where John Brown launched Bloody Kansas. And so, by way of way too much information, after the Kansas-Nebraska Compromise in 1854, there was an effort to settle Kansas on the part of New Englanders in advance of the plebiscite.
Were you born there?
No, I think you were still with NBC4 at the time, though, Mr. Sherwood.
I do the jokes here.
He asked for that. He asked for that, right?
That's right.
No, to be quick. So it was founded by the New England Immigrant Society along with three other towns in Kansas, Manhattan, Lawrence, and Topeka. The idea being to send people from New England to Kansas in advance of the plebiscite. So it was it's where John Brown was based. It's where Bloody Kansas was launched. And it's where I spent my summers as a young man.
And where were you born?
I was born in Kansas City, Missouri.
Oh, which is right there. Now, you learned to play baseball there. What position did you play? How much did you play Little League?
Second base. And I was a second baseman, but I was a left-handed second baseman with aspirations to play in the majors. And so,
are there any left-handed second basemen?
There's never once in the history of Major League Baseball been a left-handed second baseman. And that didn't deter me. I thought I was quick and I was pretty headstrong. But as you can imagine, that only took me so far.
Okay. Well, we're not going to dwell on this part.
Politics was a fallback from my. Now, can I actually tell a story about this? This is true involving the Nationals. I was at a reception once with Eddie Cohen, who owns the Nationals, one of the family members, and this was several years ago. The Nationals were struggling. And I actually offered to return to my baseball roots and to play second base for the Nationals. And his reaction was, well, are you any good? And my reaction was, well, have you seen your team lately? Because at the time, the second baseman wasn't strong. And so we made a deal. I had a bad right knee, and he actually set up an appointment with their orthopedic surgeon to help look at my knee. My knee was actually fixed at United Medical Center. That's another story. And he asked me what kind of contract I wanted, and I said, well, Eddie, I think I'm a real star. I think I'd like to do a month-to-month, and let's see how it goes.
We'll get into it a little bit later, but have you been in the baseball stadium?
No.
You have not been there yet. It opened in, 2005?
No.
Or 8 or whenever it was. Tell me a little bit about
Can I follow up on that?
Well, we're going to get back to the baseball and sports and stuff, but I'm just trying to get his early life, because no one knows his early life.
Have you not been to the stadium as a matter of principle, or is it just hasn't worked out that you have gone to a game yet?
I root for the Nationals, and I want to see them succeed. But out of principle, I made a commitment that as long as I was in public life, since I didn't support the public financing, that I probably shouldn't go now.
Would that change if you become mayor?
Absolutely.
When you have to lead the city?
Absolutely, without question. Yeah.
Well, before we get into those.
And they're getting better.
So you're a fair weather friend, fan. Okay, tell us something about your family. I know your mother died in 1990.
Yeah.
But I don't know if you have siblings. I don't know about your dad. You want to just give us a kind of a thumbnail sketch of your family background? Do you have brothers and sisters?
So my mother's mother died when she was 6 and her father when she was 16. And so that she dropped out of high school when she was a sophomore. She was married to a man, not my father, who was abusive. And so I think she got the whole notion. And by way of abusive, he raised police dogs and would essentially leave her on the farm. And when he would leave, he would let the police dogs loose. And so she was really constructively a captive of the house. She couldn't leave, nor could she come in. And I think that really did a number on her with respect to marriage. So she decided that was it, but she wanted a child and she had me. You know, and I think this is very helpful, candidly. You know, some would look at that as a particularly difficult struggle, being raised by a single mother without a high school education. I look at it as a great blessing, because this country really worked for me. You know, this is a country that believes in equality of opportunity, it believes in fairness, and it believes in playing by the rules. And I did those things, and I had a mother who made enormous sacrifices so I would have a chance to succeed.
You told her in an interview once that she was a tough broad.
Well, she was tough. There was no doubt about it. But you know, when you know, and many of us have had difficult lives, but one thing is sure, if you are growing up in a situation without a lot of resources, there are not a lot of opportunities for mistakes. And so you really have to color within the lines. Sometimes if you're better resourced, you can make a mistake and you can survive. But if you are not well resourced, you have to really color within the lines. My mother had a great sense of humor, by the way, and it was usually directed at me. And if I could tell just two stories. I've been on the graduation circuit, and she's been on my mind lately. My mother used to, because I was a very conscientious student, my mother used to say that I was so serious I'd make coffee nervous.
I actually have that in my notes.
Yeah, it was a great line. And then she had a, you know, another story that she would tell to embarrass me with my friends. When I was 18 months old, I had a spinal meningitis, and so, you know, in the language of the time, you know, again, they said, you know, Ms. Catania, your son will either be crippled or retarded or both. And you know, and she would always tell that story to my friends and say, look, he walks just fine. Now, you know, we're often, you know, we're a product of our past.
That's pretty funny.
Oh, she was hilarious. You know, the lesson was, although she didn't, you know, go beyond the 10th grade, she was among the smartest individuals I ever met. And a sense of humor is a great indicator of that. But, you know, we're often a product of our past. We can't escape it. And so when we look at, you know, some of the things I've championed during my tenure on the council, you know, some things I look at is squaring accounts. And when we were able to put a Children's National Medical Center run pediatric emergency room on Southern Avenue that sees 40,000 children per year on the eastern part of our city, I thought that would have been a job well done.
And we're going to get to those policy issues and what you've done as a public official. I have to ask you one more personal question, and that you are a known cat lover.
Yes, I am. I discovered.
Tell me something about your cats. Well, do you have one now or 21?
I discovered.
You know how they do? They're like rabbits.
I discovered cats and gin at the age of 36. It was a high water mark. It was a great year. My first cat I still have is Lillian Rosenberg. All my cats are Jewish. We had Morty Schwartz, who would flirt with Lillian Rosenberg and got himself an outdoor house as a result. Morty Schwartz passed away. That was a summer that we didn't take a vacation because his vet bills associated with his illness, you know, ended any hopes of going away. Last year we lost Woody Levinson, and Woody was my favorite animal of all times. And so, you know, we aren't Jewish, but we said Shiva and we had people over, we covered the mirrors. And so when Woody left, I was really distraught, and so I went beyond cats, and we now have a cat and a dog. And the dog is not Jewish. The dog is simply Hunter. And we went, we had the Bark Ball Humane Society Gala Saturday night, and you know, we brushed him, and he promptly rolled in the grass and got dirty right as we walked into the front door.
It's like children and dogs. You can't really control them. All right, so you came, fast forwarding, you as you grew up, then you came to Georgetown University. You wanted to study in the Foreign Service. You speak fluent German.
Yeah.
And then you went to law school and got a law degree from Georgetown.
That's right.
Well, and you didn't go into the Foreign Service. You went into local politics. What happened?
So this is, boy, Tom is really intending to embarrass me to no end. So in... While I was at Georgetown as an undergrad, I was very interested in East European studies, and so I wrote the East European Studies certificate program at the School of Foreign Service. I had an opportunity while at Georgetown. I was Madeleine Albright's research assistant, and so in 89 and 90, when the Velvet Revolution came in the Czechoslovakia, we ran the event out of her house in Georgetown because the secret police would still had infiltrated the embassy. It still infiltrated the embassy, and we couldn't trust that they would run the event. I had you know, was that following summer. I founded an organization after I met President Havel. He asked that we do something for the students. And so we, a good friend of mine, Ann Clunan, and I founded this organization called Students for Czechoslovakia. I'm really proud of the fact that we beat the Peace Corps to Eastern Europe. We were the first. We put 126 English teachers on the ground in two offices by June of 1990. But you know, this is responsive. But in the process of putting that organization, putting that infrastructure together, I was the Czechoslovak desk officer at the State Department that summer. It was an internship, and I learned that, you know, I wasn't well cut out for diplomacy. I wasn't well cut out.
We'll get into that shortly too.
The truth sometimes, I often joke I'm the second person to hear what I say. And that is not exactly a good indication, or that's not a good quality in the Foreign Service. But I have incredible respect and admiration for the people who do it. But to your point, after I graduated, and I still remain very close friends with the secretary, I went to Georgetown and then graduated, clerked for two federal administrative law judges at the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, and then was a natural gas lawyer at Akin Gump.
Then you served one term as an agency commissioner, but I'm going to let Mark get in and ask some questions. That kind of gives the people, they're so often in our lives, we don't know who the people are. We know their public persona. I think you've probably heard things here that you wouldn't have expected to hear about his life. What I like as a reporter is that political people, in fact, are real human beings, whether you vociferously disagree with them or think they're the greatest thing. They all have real lives behind the facade of being a public official. So thank you for those stories. And I'll turn it over to Mark to make it a lot tougher.
If I could continue to intrude upon your personal life, if you don't mind.
Sure.
Well, first, how did you pay for school? You talked about your modest upbringing in Kansas and Missouri, then to Georgetown University, which doesn't come cheap.
That's right. Scholarships, and I worked my way through school.
What did you do as a job working your way through college? Anything we'd be interested in?
So I worked at the Alumni Association. I worked on the Hill for Senator Jack Danforth, who was the then senior senator from Missouri. And then I went to work at the Banana Republic. And I worked for Dr. Albright.
Were you stocking or selling?
Yeah, tell us about your retail experience.
I actually enjoyed that a lot.
Like folding sweaters?
Did you wear the little microphone thing, the earphone thing?
That was in the 80s. I mean, we barely had transistor radios at the time. I mean, seriously. No, it was a great job, the Banana Republic in Georgetown. You know, but look, it was, it's funny how I used to live on $30 a week. That was the entire allowance for the entire week. That's what I would, fortunately, you block out the things, you block out parts of the struggle, and you only remember the incredible generosity and opportunity of the people who made it possible. And one of the reasons I'm so focused on the DC Promise Initiative and making sure that we, open up doors of opportunity for our kids, is basically, it's rooted in the history that I have. And I know we have incredibly talented kids in the city who, for want of some resources, will never see what they're capable of. And I think the whole city is diminished as a result.
You, go ahead.
I was just going to suggest that as we talk, I apologize to the people that you're right there. It's very difficult. I do want you, if you could, just occasionally look over there and make sure they're awake. All right, but let's go
keep
to
them honest.
Public policy.
So, well, if I could just stay on your personal life.
Sure.
So you were standing...
It's only an hour.
You were standing next to Pete Cahill the other day at Wilson High School.
Sure.
in a moment that I think was clearly seen around the city, if not around the country, when he came out in front of his entire student body. The principal of Wilson High School in Northwest Washington. And he was flanked by yourself and Mayor Gray. It made me wonder about your journey and your coming out experience. It's something that I don't know that I've ever heard you talk about. Can you tell us a little bit about that decision-making process and when you did that?
So I think I was aware of my sexuality in high school, and I think one of the reasons why I was so intent on being busy at school was to obscure the conversation discussion. If I was at debate tournaments every Friday and Saturday night and studying 24 hours a day, no one ever asked about personal life. I ultimately So, you know, I was active in local, you know, Missouri politics, Republican politics, when it was moderate, not the party that exists now. And, you know, there were folks in the circles who saw me as a promising kid, and my mentor, who had been the state secretary of the party. I'll never forget having a conversation with her in her house. This would have been in 1989, and or 88 rather, 88. And, you know, coming out to her was a big deal to me because it was the future that I had thought I would have, because I'd wanted to run for office in Missouri. And so it was about 3 a.m. and she was the quintessential country club Republican with frosted roots and the long nails, and it was three martinis in. And I should say that, you know, the conversation was predicated on my first boyfriend trying to kill himself on Halloween. And so these are very personal
1988.
Items. 1988, right. He tried to kill himself on Halloween in part because of the, you know, it was a different time there when people had different degrees of acceptance and whether or not we thought we would have futures. And so that prompted the conversation, and Barbara wanted to know why Michael had tried to kill himself. And she said, which of the two G's was it, grades or girls? And she sat there smoking. I said, well, it's neither of those G's. It's the third G. It's he's gay, and, you know, by the way, so am I. And I'll never forget her taking the drag on the cigarette and saying, well, that takes care of the fourth G. He'll never be governor. And I mean, of course, that was, you know, no one was really thinking about that. But in that moment, which had compassion in it, but it was also fully, you know, there was a realization there that my future was not in Missouri, that there were very real limitations. One of the reasons I love this city so much is because it gave me a future when my home would not.
So if we could move into some of the public policy, you came to Washington as a Republican. Mm-hmm. I spent a lot of time as a Republican in Washington, D.C.
And one term as an ANC member, where, well, you criticized me when I gave a speech for not covering you.
You all know that it all comes back to Tom.
It's all eventually. About me.
And we'll be talking about Dream City, which has just been reissued, by the way, and you can get it online if anybody's looking for a copy. Tom has it in his trunk.
I gave a speech to hundreds of people in DuPont Circle, and this rude guy, no, he wasn't rude, he was just insistent, and he stood up and said, why don't you cover the ANCs? We do all the work. We're on the ground. We do this. We do that. And after it was over, he walked up and introduced himself as David Catania. You remember that?
I think you embellish a bit, but that's fine. That's fine.
I'm in the media. I don't embellish.
The point is, you know, that I want to be clear. The Republican Party that I grew up in Osawatomie, Kansas, and Kansas is nothing like what it exists, what we see today. You know, the party that you know, I like, the tradition that I come from is the tradition from Osawatomie. These were abolitionists. It was like a time capsule. These were folks where you help your neighbor, and government try to stay out of folks' way. And you know, and by the time I got here, the party was already in a pretty interesting trajectory, and it's one that I no longer identify with in any way.
And you've been an independent for 10 years. I think it was 2004 that you made the break.
Mm-hmm.
And you've won 5 citywide elections.
Yep.
When you first won in 1997. Make sure I remember it correctly. I think Linda, you won the seat that had been held by Linda Kropp. Is that correct?
That's right.
Linda Kropp, you went on the council. You said then that you would finish that term and maybe serve one full term, and that would be it.
You know, I did say that, Tom, and I really appreciate that every time we meet, you remind me of that conversation. You know, I'm really never going to be at a loss for my memory as long as you're around. I'm thrilled.
I'm preparing your obituary now, and that's one of those, isn't it?
Oh, dear. No, you know, to be candid, I
had, you said you shouldn't have said that.
No, it's just at the time it was what I thought. I thought that 5 years would be enough. I never really saw this as a career. In fact, I feared it as a career, to be candid. You know, I had a pretty great future at Aiken Gump as a natural gas lawyer. By the way, I actually find that stuff interesting. Most of the time, when I would back in the 90s tell people what I did for a living, you know, the snooze odometer would kind of go off the charts because no one really is riveted by gathering facilities and rate cases. But I actually thought it was interesting. And so I thought, you know, I wanted to do both. I wanted to maintain a practice, maintain a future there, and I didn't see it for as long, but as it's been. But to be honest, I got so interested in the problems that we were confronting and the solutions that, you know, that were possible and the promise of our city, I just stuck with it.
Former council member Sharon Ambrose, who's in the audience, where is she? Over here? Where is she?
Yes.
Said when you came onto the council and we'll talk a little about your personality and your approach to public service, because it's aggressive. And Sharon Ambrose, who's here and supports you for mayor and worked with co-chair or whatever, well, she better support you. She called you a junkyard dog. You bark loudly at things that you don't like. What is your, you know, you, I was at a party last night where Marion Barry was, and there was somebody there who was just, they didn't like your personality. And then I said, well, what kind of field are you in? And he said, pharmaceuticals. And I said, well, I'm not surprised.
That makes sense.
Yes, because you went after the pharmaceutical industry. But, you know, you've heard the complaints that you're too aggressive, that it's a blood sport, that you, Nat Gandhi used to be a foot taller until he started appearing at council hearings where you were, that you have a very aggressive style.
Yeah.
Tell us about your style. Is it passion? Is it insensitivity? What is it?
Well, first, can I address the pharmaceutical issue? In 2007, I was named the pharmaceutical industry's number one enemy in the country. Yes. Now, the number two was the Attorney General of New Jersey. My partner was from New Jersey, so that was a point of real pride that I beat the Attorney General from New Jersey. Look, that was, I chaired for a long time the National Legislative Association for Prescription Drug Prices, which tried to improve safety, access, and quality. And there were times when we were at odds. Ultimately, though, I think what my organization was able to do really changed the country. Things like preferred drug lists, licensing of marketers, collecting of marketing data, you know, and a whole host of other things which we advocated for as a part of a national legislative association, which are now folded into the Affordable Care Act. I'm really proud of that. As far as the personality, I will be the first to say that, you know, often I see things that make me, that are outrageous that happen in our city. And I think often we're around our kitchen tables and we see things that make us outraged. The difference is sometimes there's a mic in front of me. And so, you know, that's true. I think over the last 17 years, I've gotten much better at directing that outrage, but it's no less diminished. You know, when we have, there are plenty of things to be outraged about. Only 63% of our students graduating on time, you know, having you know, nearly 8,000 homeless individuals in our city, having, you know, an uncertain, for many of our folks, and tenuous housing, not to mention, you know, the health disparities which continue to grip our city. There are things to be outraged about, to say nothing of the corruption. And candidly, I've witnessed this for years. And, you know, there are times when I absolutely could have done a better job of directing that frustration. But I don't apologize for having the passion that I have to try to tackle problems. I look at big public policy issues kind of like bombs. And some leaders run towards them and some do not. And I believe our job as leaders in the city, there are only 13 of us on the council and one mayor. And I look back at where I've directed that passion, and I'm very proud of it. I'm proud of cutting the rate of uninsured from 13.6% to 6.2% as chairman, the second lowest rate in the country. The passion brought around a 3.1% rate of uninsured for children, the lowest in the country. Smoke-free DC, medical marijuana, marriage equality. Last week when the council voted on our budget, it includes nearly $80 million in funding for students who are defined as at risk, the largest single investment in our city's history in trying to close the achievement gap. These things don't happen without, you know, without a certain amount of steel and focus and tenacity. And I appreciate that, you know, I need to do a better job at times directing it in a more constructive way. But at the end of the day, we have big challenges and we need to confront them.
some have already been talking about the tone of this campaign. Before I go further, by a show of hands, how many people here are undecided as to how they'll vote for mayor? So people have already been talking about the tone of this campaign, which may or may not be underway. We haven't had a real debate yet at all between the three candidates. But you sent out a flyer directed toward Muriel Bowser, and then after Carol Schwartz entered the race, there were people, supporters of you, who were calling her Suleiman Schwartz, comparing her to just a straw candidate for, you know, Suleiman Brown. Is that the tone that you want to set for this campaign?
Look, I think running for mayor is not a garden party. This is not a garden party governing the city. And, you know, I think, you know, part of what you do in campaigns is to draw a contrast between yourself and your opponents. And if we could, we'll use the one piece involving, I think you're referring to, involving Ms. Bowser. And what I did was I took quotes from a Washington Post story and I put them on the front page of an ad. And it talked about the people around her, you know, that being from the same camp as our previous mayor. People thought that was a criticism of Adrian. No, it was a criticism, as the story, as the piece clearly said, of some of those around her who were also around him. And a couple of individuals, you know, who were featured in the Trout report that the council issued following the waste, fraud, and abuse associated with the Parks and Rec contracts at the end of the Finty administration. Those are people who are now around my opponent, one of whom touts himself as the future, you know, deputy mayor for economic development. The other individuals, you know, the Trout report explained in no uncertain terms that they had enriched themselves considerably at the city's expense. And so I'm simply drawing a contrast between those around her and those around me. You know, similarly, the piece that you're mentioning was constructed for Congress Heights Parade in Ward 8. And it contrasted my record with respect to Ward 7 and 8 and my opponent's record. And so I mentioned, you know, the $100+ million investment into United Medical Center that I helped engineer, the increase in the rate of insured, the increased funding for primary care clinics, the work that I did to restore cuts to the high schools in the community, and I contrasted that with her record.
The Washington Post has, over the years of your service, been mostly very supportive, and I think has endorsed you for various elections. But the paper has endorsed Muriel Bowser in the April primary, has not done a formal endorsement yet for general election, but the tone seems to be that they will stick with her for the election. What is your own thoughts about the impact and the influence of the Post editorial page? And I acknowledge that most people who don't get the endorsement don't think it's worth anything, and those who get it think it's gold. But beyond that superficial view.
Well, you know, I actually have given a lot of thought to that, having been someone who's received their endorsements in the past. I think you're probably right. I'm not inclined. I don't believe I'm going to get the endorsement this time around, and I think it has a lot to do with the approach I've taken towards my chairmanship on the Committee on Education. I think the it's safe to say that the person who writes the editorials for the
Joanne
district,
Armeo,
a Maryland resident, by the way, I think it's kind of, as an aside, we sometimes bristle at members of Congress who don't live here telling us how to live our lives, and yet we have an editorial writer for the Washington Post who doesn't live here, who writes editorials to tell us how to live our lives. But anyway, I digress. You know, I think there was a great disagreement between what I viewed as the role of the Committee on Education and their view. And I think it has made me ineligible for their endorsement, if I can elaborate. Their view is that the chancellor, no matter who it is, and the mayor should have complete and total control and say, and it should be, the council should be like small children, seen but not heard. I candidly don't accept that and believe that the council has a role through the appropriations and oversight process. It doesn't mean we interfere and diminish with the operations of schools, but we have a role. And I want to mention just, you know, a couple of examples, if I might.
Just to make it clear, you asked for an education committee from Chairman Mendelson, and he gave it to you.
I did ask for it. And I asked for it because I wasn't satisfied with us, the fact that I didn't believe we were making progress as quickly as we needed to. After the takeover in 2007 of our schools, the subject of education was kept in the Committee of the Whole, which meant the chairman of the council was both the chairman of the whole council and also the chairman of the subject matter of education. And many of us thought that that was just too big of a responsibility for the chairman and that he couldn't do both, no matter how talented our previous chairman had been. I was there when we actually moved school reform, and I never remembered us, when we approved school reform, suggesting that the council would vacate the field entirely, rather that we would be partners like any other government agency in approving the schools. I asked to be chairman, and I set a pretty ambitious goal at the beginning of being chairman. I wanted us to visit all of our public schools. And when I say public, I mean our charters and our traditional schools. And so as of last Wednesday, I finished my 144th substantive school visit. And these are roughly 2 hours in length. 1 hour is spent discussing with the principal how we might set that school up to succeed and remove paths between students and success. And then I spend about an hour with students. And it has been an incredible experience. I see firsthand the talent and the quality of our leaders and our teachers. I think we are on the verge of something really remarkable in public education. The fact that I see a role for the council doesn't mean in any way that I want to see a retreat in school improvement. To the contrary, I think you want an educated council being good partners in the process. Among other things, I recall, you know, the post dinged me on pretty hard was last year when I attempted to stem some of the losses associated with school budgets, including Stuart Hobson, which would have seen about a 14% reduction in its budget. And so I introduced a measure that kept reductions to 5%, because I thought you can't build through subtraction. And so we tried to stem the loss, because you can't build programs, you can't attract people to your schools if you're cutting faculty and cutting programming. And they thought that was an incredible intrusion into the chancellor. You know, but there are reasons why, you know, I think I probably said enough there, but I believe that the council has a role. And over the last 16, 17 months, in addition to the school visits, I've introduced a number of measures that I think are important, and if I could just talk about them. One, in the aftermath of the allegations of testing integrity issues, I authored the toughest testing integrity law in the country. Rather than try to figure out who shot John 5 years ago, I thought we needed a better system going forward. I introduced an Attendance Accountability Act to try to strengthen our in-seat attendance and to rearrange, you know, prioritize truancy. I introduced a parent empowerment measure, which
you initially wanted to jail parents who had a chronic truism with their students.
But actually, it's been the law for more than 20 years that two unexcused absences is a crime in our city. The fact that in 20 years we never once prosecuted. And I thought the law as it was with two...
Pardon me, we're rearranging the furniture.
Yeah.
I thought the law that exists today that says two unexcused absences in a month can lead to a prison sentence, I thought that was ridiculous, so I was trying to amend it to 10. The fair funding bill is one that I'm very proud of, and this again came from the visits, my school visits. When I would be in schools where there were enormous concentrations of poverty, it only takes a second to realize that these kids need more resources, okay? And when I started studying, you know, how other jurisdictions fund schools, I found that we were to the right of Texas. I mean, even Texas understands, I'm sorry if any of you are from Texas, but even Texas understands the need for kids at risk. And so we looked at the research, I have a great staff, and we looked at, you know, how do you define which kids are defined as being at risk? These are children who are homeless in the foster care system, kids on welfare, kids on food stamps, and kids who are 1 year older than their peers in high school, as the evidence suggests that these are groups most at risk. So last Tuesday in the budget, we passed the first ever budgeted fair funding bill, which gives $2,200 per child, which the principal is allowed to aggregate and in consultation with the faculty decide which interventions are best suited for that particular school to close the achievement gap. It can be a longer school day, a longer school year, technology, it can be additional social emotional support, it can be reading and math intervention. But one thing I'm certain is that our school leaders and our school faculty, you know, have a good handle on each individual school. Another thing we did, and I promise, you know, I'll wrap it up after this. I noticed our social promotion policy. Now, those of you in this room who followed me have heard me say this until, you know, your eyes want to glaze over. We had a system that was set up to fail. Until the Focused Student Achievement Act, which I authored last year, it was against the law for this city to hold its elementary school students back in DCPS, except in the third, the fifth, or the eighth grade. And so I recount all the time this principal I ran into at Bacchus, who had a seventh grader, who told him, I don't have to come to school, I don't have to do the work, there's nothing you can do about it, and you have to pass me. And the loss was on the child's side. And so you can understand a system that just kind of has cascading failure up, where no one is focused on making sure the child has mastered the content at the end of a school year. Accountability hits our students in the ninth grade, where they had to earn language and algebra credits in order to be sophomores. And every year, 30% of our kids failed. And so our truancy and our failure is all, it all collides. They show up, they start to fail, and they stop coming. That's why our freshman classes are about 2.5 times the size of our sophomore classes, why we have 19-year-olds in the ninth grade. And, you know, we can do better. And that's really what my campaign is focused on. So rather than have the law say you have to be promoted, we return this issue to principals and teachers to decide who would be promoted and how, with the idea of having greater school accountability on a child-by-child basis.
The mayor has total control of the schools in terms of the chancellor. Kaya Henderson is the chancellor. She was deputy mayor, deputy chancellor with Michelle Ree. She's been there most recently. Muriel Bowser changed position from saying she wouldn't talk about appointees, but has said she would support keeping Kaya Henderson. You've been working with Kaya Henderson as a chairman of the education committee. Right. You've had regular meetings with her, breakfast or weekly meetings. You've clashed some, you've worked together. Can you tell us tonight that you see Kaya Henderson staying on if you become mayor?
You know, I just want to take exception to the word clashed, because I don't see us having clashed. I see us at times not agreeing.
Full-throated conversations.
Never. We've never raised our voices with one another. Our conversations have always been cordial and professional. She explains her point of view. You know, as I, you know, I view my job as supporting the chancellor, and I talk about us all the time being partners in leadership, because we have the same goal in mind, which is to make sure that every child in every neighborhood has a chance to succeed without exception.
And I just she says good things about you, so.
So as far as, you know, I think it's premature. I personally believe it's premature to talk about personnel. I just think, you know, personnel is a subject that you decide after you are elected. There are many people who will be part of this discussion, you know, superintendent, a deputy mayor, et cetera. I haven't ruled anything out or in. What's important for people to know is that I'm committed to the trajectory of school improvement with a greater intensity. That is born out of what I think is probably unparalleled experience with respect to our schools. And if I'm lucky enough to be mayor, I'm going to be very hands-on in terms of establishing targets, of narrowing achievement gap, increasing our graduation rates, adding career and technical education into our schools, and making sure our kids who are graduating have the chance to pursue college.
You don't think it gives the voter an insight into how you would govern to tell them, I mean, would you keep Chief Ellerbe around?
Well, he's no longer. Can I answer it differently? Because I think we fixate in this city on personalities as opposed to good organizations. And let me, if I might, for a second. How do we approach our workforce as a city? Have we given any thought to that? I mean, how many of you have been frustrated by our workforce at times? How many of you have wondered why it takes, you know, an act of Congress at times to get a permit without an expediter, okay? Let's just take a second and think about what kind of organization we want. You know, to build a great organization, you have to focus on a number of elements. And the first thing you don't do as the mayor is you don't attack your workforce, because you need these individuals. No good leader is going to attack his workforce or her workforce. We need to make them better for themselves and for us. And so how do we do this? We look at recruiting. Who are we recruiting and how? What are the personality characteristics? What are the aptitudes of the people we're trying to recruit? We look at how you educate your workforce. I can tell you, for years, I've wanted and waited for us to invest in our people so they actually can do the work we expect of them. The third issue is evaluation. How do you evaluate? Do we have a single, coherent, fair system of evaluation? And the answer is no. Are our evaluations tethered to promotion? They should be. but they're not. And finally, what is our retention policy for keeping really good workers? Now, what are we doing to build a really good organization where people can start as a GS5 and work their way up if they apply themselves? You know, one of the mantras I talk about in my office all the time is, what messages are we sending? And what messages are we sending when we constantly say we have to leave the city to find talent? What does it say to the people who start at the bottom or even in the middle and want to work their way up? The message is, you know, we don't have good people here. I think, you know, loyalty is a two-way street, and I think we should be as invested in our workers as we expect them to be in us. I imagine some of the resentment we find among some of our employees is because we have really left them to their own devices without an opportunity for advancement, with little respect and with little investment. I had an opportunity to do this work, and I'm sure, you know, it's going to come up. I actually was a vice president of corporate strategy for a large company, a large multinational company, until the end of 2012, while I was also on the council. We had 35 offices.
Is that MC Dean?
Yes. We had 35 offices and 3,000 employees around the world. And my job was, among others, to be responsible for organizational development, to make sure that we were hiring and creating the very best organization in the world. We wanted to be the best designed engineer firm in the world. And we knew we couldn't do it if we didn't build the workforce. So imagine if, and no one is going to vote on for anyone based on how nerdy you can get about evaluations, but if we want to create a great city and a great bureaucracy that future leaders can actually execute what they want to do and serve all of us, we're going to need to put a little attention into it. And that's what I would propose to do.
So non-committal on Chief Ellerbe. I'll put you down as a maybe.
Well,
so
he'll be gone July 2nd.
Let me talk about Chief Ellerbe.
Well, you know what?
Not too long.
He is going to be gone. Because can I get to some of the questions from the audience?
May I talk about Ellerbe?
Sure, go right ahead.
20 seconds.
You know, you cannot succeed and be at war with your workforce. And I think the difference between Chief Ellerbe and the workforce, the ad hominem attacks, the discord, the lack of respect, you know, sit down with 36 and figure out if you don't like their solution, they don't like yours, reasonable people can reason with one another.
Local 36, well, the union. Just
yes. So well, people know what 36 Chief Lanier are. Has been at war with her rank and file for over the pretty much the exact same issues for the exact same amount of time, but I don't think anyone is calling for her resignation.
Less vitriol between Lanier and the FOP, in my view.
But that's the same thing going on between Ellerbe and the union, in his union.
I think there were personnel.
What she says, she doesn't engage in the personal back and forth.
No. All right. Well, we've gotten off track. Let's get to some of the audience questions. If we could do a little rapid fire, so we can get to as many. These are issue-based questions that I think they want to get your feel on. Should you become mayor? So if we can kind of I'll keep the questions brief, and keep the answers brief.
Right.
Got several questions on bicycles. From the gist of the questions, I'm guessing they're from people who own cars. And so they want to know what you're going to do about bike lanes and bicyclists who don't obey the laws.
So I had a bike for 2 weeks. It was stolen. That was God telling me I should keep my car. I believe that there's, that we have a number of probably 200 miles of one-way streets in our city that are 30 feet in length, which are sufficient for parked car traffic, bike parked car. I think we are able to reason with one another and find a way to have win-wins. Candidly, I'm exhausted with the zero sum that we often have, and I'm not blaming the bike folks or the car folks. I do, though, believe that everyone should obey the traffic laws, period.
And you're for bike lanes? You think that's a good thing?
I think one-way streets that are 30 feet, I mean, it just so happens our streets are really well positioned to have a bike lane, as well as, one-
But only in one-way streets?
Well, one-way streets because, it has a traffic calming effect, having a bike lane.
So down the middle of Pennsylvania Avenue?
I think it gets really dicey when you're talking about two-way.
Let's talk about the elected attorney general. Should the election be held this year?
Yes.
And is
would
this...
You,
go ahead.
Would he run for it?
That was going to be my next
No, I wouldn't run it for it. But I
would. You would never consider running for elected attorney general?
This year?
Ever. I'm running for mayor. But I want to talk about bikes for just a second, because I realize there are controversies. There's controversy surrounding them. But have we ever talked or considered what bikes mean for economic development? Seriously, they have it. And Alice Speck is here, and her husband wrote a fantastic book called Walkable City. And I learned something by reading it. The average American spends between 10 and 20% of their income on a bike, I mean on a car. If you can get them into public transportation on bike or multimodal, you can actually get them out of their cars. Where will they spend that 10 to 20% of their income? They'll spend it in their neighborhood bars and restaurants and retail. So rather than export all of that money overseas for oil or around the world for cars, it actually does mean additional monies staying here, circulating in our economy. I'm not at war with cars. In fact, I just said, I'm wedded to mine. But I think we have to look for ways to reason with one another and find win-wins.
So you're in favor of drunk bicyclists going to bars? The media can turn anything into a negative.
Fine,
Tom. The future of the homeless shelter at D.C. General. The future of the homeless shelter at D.C. General under
And we're starting to run out of time, so
okay.
Lightning round.
You know, I don't see how we close it unless we have an alternative. And, you know, I think the problem is that we haven't engaged in anything approaching affordable housing planning for years. We certainly haven't executed. And the result of a failed housing policy is a homelessness crisis. I know people are eager to see the facility closed, but we simply can't close it with no place for folks to go. And so it's about time for us to actually execute a housing policy so that we can, that takes into consideration the types of folks we're trying to house on transit-rich routes and at long last executed. I'm sorry, these are complicated questions.
They are. That's why we like to dumb it down.
I'm sorry to give them short answers.
Traffic cameras, enough is enough, or the more the merrier?
I think traffic cameras, we've become addicted to them. They're like heroin. And so our budgets are really balanced on traffic cameras. And
$85 million a year.
We're estimating another $50 million, you know, in this upcoming budget. I think traffic cameras should be for public safety, traffic calming, and not for I gotcha. And so I'm very worried about how much our revenue is growing, how dependent we're becoming on them.
Can I go back to schools for a moment, because it's an important question. The turmoil over the boundaries and the proposals from the mayor's administration and formal decision going to come in September. Are you for or against the redistricting of the primary and middle schools? What do you think should be done to right-size the boundaries, if that's... And also, what about children who... We have such a good elementary school system that people from Maryland particularly bring their children into our school and actually take up spots in our schools that could go to citizens. What do you think about the boundary discussion and kids from out of the state?
Well, I'm a big proponent of matter of right neighborhood schools. And, you know, candidly, proponent of matter of right neighborhood schools. And, you know, my whole frustration with the boundary issue and the feeder system issue thus far has been it's the cart before the horse. We're worried about how we assign what are perceived as high quality spaces as opposed to doing the hard work and the heavy lifting of making sure that every neighborhood school is a high quality matter of right school. The ending of social promotion coupled with the at-risk funding to help bolster some of our struggling schools, I think is exactly the right approach. And if we were to do that, I think it would have an impact on the crowding in some parts of our city.
Said you would hit the pause button and delay the boundary, whatever changes there are, delay a year while you put some of the reforms in the schools, the middle schools, and get more reforms in
place. I just don't know how in good conscience we move children into lower performing schools. You know, and I just don't think that makes sense. I think our focus has to be on improving the matter of right schools. It doesn't happen overnight. It doesn't mean that we throw out all the good work that has been done by the Boundary and Feeder Initiative, group. But I got to tell you, I'm really worried about having this discussion in the middle of an election, because I don't want it politicized on my part or my opponent's part. I think it makes sense just to focus on improving neighborhood schools. None of the work that's been done thus far will be wasted, and this can be picked up in January.
What about Maryland kids who go to D.C. schools? People say you just stand outside any school, yeah, and you can see the Maryland tags driving up and dropping off kids for our day-long school.
Yeah, I've seen that, and it's especially in pre-K 3 and 4. I've had a number of graduations for pre-K 4 where I ask the families where are they going next year, and they're going to Maryland. And so this is one of the functions of OSSE, our Office of State Superintendent of Education, and we need to actually dedicate some resources to make sure that we can identify and follow through. And we really have made that about the lowest priority. And it has to be priority, because these funds we're using to educate our children. We don't begrudge anyone a good quality of education, but the overcrowding and the use of our tax dollars to educate the residents of Maryland and Virginia is just not acceptable.
Stadiums, RFK, DC United. What's the future of RFK and what's the future of a new soccer stadium?
So I support the new stadium, and I've spoke to Mr. Ackridge, Chip Ackridge, on Saturday, and representatives from the team on Friday, and explained that, you know, if what we're trying to do is to build a soccer stadium, let us figure out how much we need in order to do the land, the environmental remediation, the land purchasing and transportation, and let's do that. Let's set that stadium up to succeed. I'm not a fan of the land swap with the Reeves Center. We may very well want to renovate and or dispose of that site to a different use, but I don't want to complicate what we're trying to do here, which is to build a stadium. And I think
you want to, in some form, use public money to help build the stadium, whether it's this land swap or.
Well, so the whole reason for the Reeves Center land swap is supposedly to help us come up with the $21 million we would need to buy the Ackridge land for the purposes of constructing the stadium. Well, we have about $2 billion in the bank, and so we can take $21 million if we want to, and we can buy the land from Mr. Ackridge, and we can then focus on making the stadium a success. And that means not only building the very best stadium, but also being very respectful of the residents in Southwest about a transportation strategy, one that doesn't burden their community. If we were actually thinking bigger, we would look at how this stadium could be could come with additional amenities for the residents of Southwest, including housing. It could be a part of a bigger plan, as opposed to let's sell the Reeves Center and build the stadium and move on.
What about this, the tax breaks for the team ownership? No sales taxes, no property taxes for 5 and 10 years. That's support right. The team.
Well, you know, if Mark or if I were negotiating the deal, we might have negotiated it slightly differently. The issue is, you know, the mayor is charged with negotiating the deal. At some point, unless we have, a philosophical difference, we have to give him, or unless the deal is so beyond the pale that doesn't make sense, I want to give him the benefit of the doubt on the fact that he negotiated the very best deal for the stadium. But one thing that does not make sense to me, do you all know where the Reeves Center is at 14th and U? All right. So we're proposing its value at $56 million. The land that we're buying from Ackridge in Southwest is $21 million. Now, the CFO has assessed the value of the Reeves Center at well over $140, I think it's $144 million. So let's just assume it's somewhere between $56 and $144. The fact is there's money on the table. And what I'd like to do is I'd like to set the team up to succeed. If we're going to have a stadium where they pay about half and we pay half, and we can bring some additional development to Southwest, great. My fear is if we're making the deal more complex than it needs to be, with members of the Gray administration leaving, that we are not, the likelihood that something will fall through the cracks is greater. And if we do want to ultimately build a new government center, I'm all for that too. But let's do this well in the final days of the administration. Let's not complicate it and cheat ourselves.
Why is it okay to spend public money on a soccer stadium and you so opposed the baseball stadium?
Well, there's a difference.
And then a very quick answer, because we only have 5 minutes Fine. Left. I want to get to raw politics.
There's a difference between negotiating a deal where the city pays about half and the owners pay about half, in my mind, versus a deal where we pay $711 million and the owners pay nothing and keep the naming rights. I didn't find that a particularly self-respecting deal. And so, that was a bridge too far for me, Mark.
Some raw politics. Muriel Bowser won the Democratic primary. She's on the ballot. She's refused to appear publicly with you in any form until at least September, when the ballot is set. What is, in the most concise way you can, why are you a better person to be mayor than Muriel Bowser? You've been very critical of her lackluster record, you've said many number of things. But just kind of summarize it very quickly so we can get to Carol Schwartz.
So, look, I think securing our city's future is something that's going to require experience and tenacity. And I say all the time that this election is about trust, and trust is certainty based on past experience. And so if you look at the things I've said I would do in the past, things like marriage equality or cutting the rate of uninsured or investing more in children, when I say I'm going to do that in the future, you can trust based on my past experience. When I say I'm going to do something, I'll do it. When my opponent says she's going to make sure that everyone who wants to stay in the city can stay in the city, you have to make a judgment based on her record. For the last 16 months, she's chaired the Committee on Economic Development, which is essentially our housing committee. That's it. Department of Housing, Community Development, our Housing Production Trust Fund, our Rental Housing Commission, our Public Housing Authority, the Housing Finance Agency, the entire kettle of fish with respect to housing has been with her for 16 months. Our homelessness crisis is a function of a failed housing policy, and in 16 months, she has not moved one measure, not one, to address this issue. So when she says, you can trust me as mayor, you have to, I think it's fair to say, well, based on your past experience, is that well-placed trust? When I say, you know, I'm going to do something, you know, it is a bond. A word is a bond. And when I look at things that I have accomplished and want to accomplish for our city, I'm very excited about our future. I'm very excited about our fundamentals. And I think it's ultimately up to everyone in this room.
You think that she has qualities to be mayor? She just wouldn't be a good one?
You know, I just don't think, I think that is a determination that we each get to make in the ballot box.
Carol Schwartz has been out of office since 2008. You helped the campaign to defeat her, and she has almost hated you ever since. She's now has decided late in the game to jump into the mayor's race. She says she wants to be mayor. I don't think anyone doubts the fact that she would love to be mayor, but many people believe she's jumped into the race to deny you an election victory by taking away votes that would help Muriel Bowser win. Did it surprise you? What are your thoughts about it? And when you go in a public forum with her, how will you treat Carol Schwartz?
Well, you know, I think you will.
You agree with that analysis that she's trying to defeat you?
No, I think, you know, I'm reminded of a chance encounter you and I had in 2002, the day after the general election when Ms. Schwartz lost the second time to Tony Williams, when you said to me, you're here, had I heard anything about Carol resigning? Do you remember that conversation?
I do not.
Well,
you can make
bitch,
it up now.
No, no.
Say payback's a bitch.
So Tom,
I'm sure I believe whatever I said at the
so
time.
Tom, it was right, you know, typically, you know, in November we'll have the legislative session right after the election, the day after, the week after. And you stopped me in the hall and you told me that Carol was resigning. And I was mortified. And I went to her office to talk her out of it with Kathy Patterson and Linda Kropp. And Carol had written her speech to resign from the council in November of 2002 after her loss to Tony Williams. And because you tipped me off, we were able to talk her into staying. It's true I didn't support her in 2008. You know, there are a good many things that I think we all appreciate about, you know, Carol and her service. I think I've said all I'm going to say about why she's in the race. But ultimately, this is...
What have you said?
I just said it.
Oh, that's totally unsatisfying.
Yeah. But in all seriousness, this is a race about the future of our city, and we face some pretty substantial challenges. One of which, if I could for just a second, what's happening in Virginia. Now, those of us who kind of follow things like commercial property tax realize that Virginia has its designs on our city. And something that the Virginia Supreme Court did last November and implemented in February of this year is a frontal assault on our law firms, okay? The Virginia bar used to be very hard to get into. You'd have to sit for the bar in the state of Virginia. You would have to live in the state of Virginia. And you would have to promise that a majority of your practice would be in the state of Virginia. Virginia changed those rules. The Virginia bar did, the Supreme Court. So that now, if you are from a jurisdiction that allows people to wave into you, you can wave into them. You no longer have to live in Virginia. You no longer have to say that a majority of your practice is in Virginia. What Virginia has done is essentially, as it is the process of opening 6 new metro stations, has essentially issued an invitation to our law firms to help populate the commercial office space along those 6 new stations. Now, there are a couple of things that prop our commercial property tax base up, which is a huge part of our revenue: law firms and government. So if our law firms are able to leave to less expensive, less regulated space, that really hurts us in a commercial office context. At the same time, when our General Services Administration is claiming they're going to shrink federal space by 25%, we have some real threats, and we need to be facing them head on. We can do that. I know you've got to go.
I know.
But look, let me say, these are not insurmountable. We have incredible fundamentals in our city. We are fortunate to having lived through the last 20 years. 20 years ago, 17 years ago when I joined the council, we had a control board. And we now are in a period of great, renaissance. But the power in the future of our city, how we will be defined, how we will use that treasury to make a down payment for a more equitable city, one that reflects our shared values that I discussed earlier, that's really the challenge of our next mayor.
Thank you.
And I really appreciate everyone being here tonight.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for coming tonight. I hope you, the whole point of these sessions we're doing here at the Hill Center, and we've done Kai Henderson and Ronald Machen and other people, is to, for you to see a human side of the people that we have in public office. So thank you for coming tonight. Thank Mr. Catania for coming. And Mark.